Johnson's County, New York, but she's going to share with us and encourage us one of the most important aspects that if we lose this, we, as Brother Dick said, if it's not God, we might as well just throw it in.
Amen.
So prophetess Pastor Esther Emmons will share with us developing the prayer life of the church.
Okay. Wonderful. Well, when I was asked to do this, I was so excited and grateful to the MFI board. Thank you so much for asking me to do this, because my passion is that the church would be ignited.
Amen.
With the fires of God's love and a desire and passion to be with God and to pray and pursue Him. But then I said to myself, you know, what do I have to say? Like these two, you know, feeling small. And he said, a great church. We have a small church. We have a very small church. But I agree with you that it's a great church. And you know why? Because the Holy Spirit is in it.
Amen.
Hallelujah. And that's the whole thing, is that there is a fire that never, ever goes out. And in the Song of Solomon 8:6-7, it talks about the fires of Yah. That's the fires of God's love that never go out. It says many waters cannot quench it. And it's an intimate fire. That's the thing that sets my heart on fire. That's what made me whole in my life. Coming from a background where my Jewish parents were in the Holocaust and suffered greatly, suffering, also myself suffering a very destructive divorce. And these things I was set free of by the power of God's intimate love for me.
Wow.
Hallelujah. The only reason I'm sound is because His soundness is upon me. And His love for us, when we connect to that fire that He ignites us with, you know, this is not a man-made fire.
Amen.
We can't work this up. This comes from the Holy Ghost. This comes from people who are hungry and thirsty for God. When we get ignited, it's because we've been hungry and thirsty for Him, and He sets us on fire. And when we get in His presence, and we do what David said, you know, to behold the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in His temple, he received great gratification and satisfaction from the one whose loving kindness is better than life.
Amen.
See, the simplicity of this is where God asked me to come and direct the prayer life of the church. Because that's what He put in me. You know, Bill's and my relationship was born out of this kind of prayer. For 14 years I prayed for a husband. And I was just looking at my journal the other day. January 16th, 1999 was the day that God had me make my whole man list, because He showed me that He had this husband for me. And 2 years later, before I knew Bill, before I knew his birthday, I discovered that was his birthday. God's pretty specific. So He had a very specific idea of what He wanted done in the church. Because when I came to the Life Christian Center Church with my husband, he told me, we talked recently about it. He said, you know, honey, before you came, he said, although we had many times of intimacy and soaking in the Lord, he said it was very goal-oriented. There was always something we were going to achieve in our prayer times. He said, but you brought the relational side to the church. And that's because it was God's plan. And so, you know, there were times when I'd be in the prayer room all by myself, saying, God, what do you want here? What do you want me to do? And I began to realize over time that He wanted to ignite personal fires. Because when He gets the heart of somebody and sets it on fire for Him, then you have somebody who is going to be there for the long haul.
That's right.
They're not just coming to a prayer meeting. They're on fire. They want to bring God's will down. And that's the way that our prayer meetings are. They are pretty awesome. They are pretty awesome. Because the living God is there. And so what God did was he began to cultivate the heart of the church. And the first thing that he revealed in our Tuesday morning prayer and mentoring times was that there was a spirit of competition and comparison in the church that he wanted rooted out. And he did. As we prayed, he rooted it up and out of the church so that the true value that he felt, that God felt for each individual in the church could manifest and people could know that they were loved and cared for by God for who they were. They didn't have to compete or vie for attention.
Amen.
Then we had a great fiasco in 2008. I was there from 2001. In 2008, there was an associate pastor who the enemy used to steal a great deal of money from our church. Steal family relationships, steal our peace, steal everything. And one day we were in a prayer meeting, and the Lord showed me in the spirit this mantle of love over the sanctuary. And the devil's hand on one side, the devil's hand on the other side, trying to rip that thing off the sanctuary. And I heard the devil say, "Ugh, I can't do it." Because by now, God was rooting and grounding us in his love. We were becoming more than conquerors through Christ who strengthened us. Hallelujah. And then, because we were, the church got, at that point in time, was very messed up. We were very, very broken. So we would get together in prayer meetings and follow the leading of the Holy Spirit. And he said, pray that the church become smooth, stable, and steady. That there's a culture of honor, accountability, and transparency. God built that into the fabric of our house. We never shove things under the carpet. We always face issues. People who do not like to face issues don't like to come to our church.
It's true.
Because we hold people accountable. But it makes for a safe atmosphere where the Holy Spirit is welcome and he can move. Then, in 2012, God gave me a technicolor dream about what he was planning on doing further. And that was Bill and I were in a house by the seashore, and waves from the ocean came and lifted us up the foundation that it was on and took us out to sea 2 miles. And while Bill and I were in the house flying on the water, we were looking at each other going, "Woo, look what the Holy Ghost is doing." And then we came back and we were set back down at the shore. 2 years later, God showed. We didn't even realize, you know, when you're in a certain atmosphere, you don't realize what the atmosphere is until God reveals it. But he revealed that there was a works mentality that he had rooted up and out of the church and put a relational mentality in the church. I'm looking at time here. Okay. Hallelujah. Yeah. Yeah, and everything has changed so dramatically. We don't have time to go into it today. But let me tell you some of the personal testimonies of the things that happened. Way back when I was there at the beginning on the Tuesday morning mentoring times, the lead deacon, the woman deacon, she and her husband are the head deacons of the church. Wonderful woman of God. Just, you know, tremendous doer, can get anything done that you ask her to do. Well, she came into this prayer mentoring time. And, you know, we're hanging out in the presence of the Lord, ministering to him. The love of God is there. She told me her perception when she first came in was, "Oh, that's for Pastor Lester. No, that's not for me." But the Holy Ghost did something. He captivated her heart. And she couldn't wait to keep coming back for more and more and more. Another young daughter of the Lord, her terminology was when she came there and got established in the Lord, that she was electrified in God's presence. We have an experience, you know. We have experiences. We have encounters with him that are not fabricated by man, but come from the Holy Spirit. Another woman, another daughter of the Lord, when she came to us 5 years ago, she had been tormented with a spirit of suicide. greater part of her life, but she was on 12 different medications. And so she came in, started again, God's presence, God's love, began healing her, and I shared with her about the fact that she needed to forgive the people that abused her. She said, "Man, this is hard. This is hard." But you know what? She said when she did it, that her emotions became stabilized. She went from 12 medications down to 4 medications. And there's a smile on her face now that is so bright and healthy because it's the brightness of the living God that lives on the inside of her. I have 5 minutes to go. Okay. Friday night, prayer watch, a wonderful son of the Lord, worship leader, told me that for about 12 years as she sat when I would teach and preach on intimacy and the love of God, he said that it got on the inside of his foundation. And when he was in a prayer watch, that something happened to him. He had an encounter with God. That intimate flame of God's love set his heart ablaze. Ooh, he was always a great worship leader, but he leads worship now. You look at this guy. He is in love with the living God. And you know who he is. And that's because he had an encounter with God. Hallelujah. Another son of the Lord, super depressed, came in one night, didn't want to be there, came in out of devotion to God and devotion to us. And we were celebrating Jesus. And in song and in the dance and declaring God's goodness. And you know what happened? The Holy Ghost came in and broke that spirit of depression completely off of him. He got set free completely, and now he says, "Oh, he said, I wouldn't miss the prayer watch." He says, "There's gratification in the presence of the Lord."
Amen.
And there is breakthrough. So that's all the Holy Ghost and fire igniting us. The Father has a fire. The Father has a fire. It says in Isaiah 56, he says, "I will make you more than sons and daughters. I will give you an everlasting name and an everlasting place. I will make you joyful in my house of prayer." God did that. God did that one night. I mean, he's been doing it all along, but one night there was a special anointing for sons and daughters at the prayer watch. And I think there were about 30 of us. And Bill and I were both preaching and teaching on sons and daughters and the Lord. We were laying hands on our sons and daughters. And then there was a son that drew a picture of an Italian villa that was so beautiful. We didn't know that he had a gift of artistry that was so beautiful. And we all gathered around and we looked at it and said, that represents our house of prayer. That represents that we can be who God created us to be and become as people and enter into the giftings and callings and flow freely. It was just a beautiful, beautiful home. And then, of course, Jesus has the fire. Because we know that when he came into the temple, he turned over the tables of the money changers. He turned over the chairs. He was very upset. And he said, "It is written, my house shall be called the house of prayer. But you have made it a den of thieves." Then the blind came to him, the lame came to him, and they were made whole. We have a family who started coming to us 6 months ago. They drive an hour and 45 minutes from Vermont to get to our church every Sunday and every Tuesday for the prayer and mentoring. Because they have found the treasure they're looking for. I'm not saying that we are anything, because we are nothing.
That's right.
But it's the living God who is there that we invite and facilitate the Holy Spirit to bring life. They're finding the answers that they never had. And the wife and the mother told me it's been like 30 years that they've been searching for a place. And that's what they found here. So the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit all have a fire for the house of prayer. We are all called. Every church is different. Every church is unique. Each one here. But we know we're all called to be a house of prayer. And my prayer for each and every one is that we would simply follow the leading of the Holy Ghost and get ignited
Amen.
With the fires of the personal love that he has so that not only is it personal, but then it blows forth into the corporate plans and purposes that God has.
Amen.
Thank you, Pastor Church, but it's a great experience of Life Christian Center where we got to the office now. It's a great place. And good friends and serving in the hall for lots of years now. Our next panelist is